In this video, we're computing the gravitational potential energy between two point masses. So in our picture, we see two different point masses. One is big M, one is little m. And what we're doing in this process is moving little m from an initial position of R1 all the way to a final position of R2, where those R's stand for the center-to-center separation distance between the two masses. Now, the reason we're going through this process is because in order to find a potential energy function, we need to compute the work done by the conservative force of gravity as we go from this initial to final state. And then recall that the work done by a conservative force is equal to the negative of the change in the potential energy function. So once we compute that work integral, we'll be able to define our potential energy function. So to get things started, just a quick reminder of Newton's law of gravitation. So the magnitude of the force of gravity is given by big G, that's the universal gravitational constant, times the product of the two masses, then divided by the separation distance between them squared. And of course, gravity is an attractive force. So that's going to give you the direction at any moment. It's always going to act to pull two masses toward each other. Now we need to find the work done by gravity as we move this little mass m from that initial position to the final position. So we're just picking it up and moving it radially from R1 to R2. And because the force of gravity is varying along that path, this produces an integral. And we're going to integrate from R1 to R2, and we take the force, I'll call it FG vector, dotted into dr, where dr is a small radial increment. So it's helpful to visualize this with an intermediate position between the starting and finishing positions. So there's our little m just at some intermediate position between the initial and final positions. And the force of gravity is pulling opposite to its direction of motion because it's an attractive force. And then we've shown a little increment in path dr pointing along its path from the initial to final position. Now notice that the force of gravity is in the opposite direction as dr here, and that means this dot product produces a minus sign. Because these two vectors are anti-parallel, the dot product turns out to have a magnitude that's just equal to the magnitude of each vector multiplied, but the minus sign is produced by that cosine of 180 degrees because they're pointing in the opposite direction. Now we can plug in Newton's law of gravitation, and I'll just move the constants out in front. So I have negative g big M little m times the integral from R1 to R2 of 1 over r squared dr. Now when we integrate 1 over r squared, that's the same as r to the negative 2. We use the power rule on that and we get r to the negative 1 over negative 1. In other words, this produces a minus sign, and that's going to wipe out the minus sign that was in front, and it produces a 1 over r. So we need to evaluate this from R1 to R2. When we sub in the upper limit, we get a 1 over R2. And then the lower limit, we subtract that, of course, and we get 1 over R1. So there's the work done by gravity as we travel this path from the initial to final position. And I want to point out here, we know the work done by gravity must be a negative number because it's always pointing opposite to the direction of motion. So when I look at the difference in parentheses, R2 is bigger than R1, which means 1 over R2 is a smaller number than 1 over R1, and that guarantees that we're looking at a negative quantity, so everything is working the way it's supposed to. So now to relate to a potential energy function, we have to use this fact that the work done by gravity is equal to the negative of the change in a potential energy function. So we have to take this expression that we just derived from the work integral, and then look at that as a negative of a change. And when I say a change, I mean a final minus initial value. So what I'm going to do is distribute that GMm into the parentheses, but I'm also going to multiply the inside and outside of those parentheses by negative 1. So this gives me negative, and then negative G big MM over R2. And then I'm going to leave this minus in between rather than simplifying. So minus negative g big M little m over R1. And I've managed to express this as a negative of a final state minus initial state. So a negative of a change in potential energy function. And that implicitly tells us that what we're looking at in this first term is the potential energy at the position R2. And what we're looking at in the second term is the potential energy at the position R1. So that's the negative of a change in a potential energy function. with the potential energy between two point masses as a function of their separation distance is given by negative G big M little m over R. Now this seems a little strange that we end up with a potential energy function that's always a negative value. So it's worth investigating the graph of this function to get a little better understanding for what's going on. So remember, R is the separation distance between these two masses, big M and little m, and then our gravitational potential energy function as a function of separation distance is negative GMm over R, and it looks like this curve. So I see some good things here. First, I notice that as R decreases, in other words, the separation distance between the two masses goes down, the potential energy function is decreasing. So that makes good physical sense, because we know if we just start two masses from rest and allow them to get pulled toward each other under the force of gravity, we're going to see kinetic energy emerge from that, and that means the gravitational potential energy should be going down. The other key feature I see here is that if we take the limit as R goes to infinity, we see our gravitational potential energy leveling off to zero. And it's a little weird to have zero as a maximum value for a potential energy function. But remember, for the purpose of solving any conservation of energy problem, the location of your origin doesn't matter. All that matters is the change in potential energy between the starting point and the finishing point. And as long as we have a function that's showing us a potential energy that goes down as the two objects get closer together, we can understand how it's working correctly. Okay, the last thing I want to do in this video is to actually do a little check on our work. Recall that if I have a force defined in one dimension, and this is after all a one-dimensional context here, we're just going to tilt our single R axis to follow the path of little m. I can obtain the force as a function of R by taking the negative derivative of the potential energy function with respect to R. So what we're going to do is just try to verify that we get Newton's law of gravitation back from this potential energy function. So then I sub in my potential energy function, but notice the potential energy function comes with a minus sign. So that's going to cancel the minus sign that's hanging out in front of this derivative. So what I want to find is the R derivative of G big M little m over R. And when I differentiate this, that's all constants in the numerator, and then an R to the negative 1, which differentiates to negative 1 over R squared. So now I end up with another minus sign, and I end up with negative GMm over R squared. All right, so that's Newton's law of gravitation, but what's up with the minus sign? The issue there is that we're working along this R axis where we're treating away as the positive direction, and this minus sign simply means the gravitational force is pointing opposite to the positive direction for R. So we've recovered Newton's law of gravitation from this potential energy function, and for now, we're done. In the next video, we're going to show that this general expression for the gravitational potential energy between two point masses reduces to the familiar mgy for an object that's constrained really close to the surface of the Earth. I'll post a link to that video at the upper left, and I'll see you there.